So let's move on to the peer-to-peer model. The peer-to-peer model looks a bit different. We don't call the host machine a client anymore. It's called a node or a peer, but it still is the same host sitting in our local area network. It still has to contend with a NAT and a firewall. The objective in peer-to-peer is not to go to a server, but to have a service that goes from one node to another node. And really, application has to enable that. There are different set of challenges on peer-to-peer than the client-server model. In the client-server model, the server is really well known because there's a URL associated with it, and that gets advertised. And so if you want to use that service, you go to the URL. But peer-to-peer services, generally, you don't have a URL for the host you're trying to contact. This would be for services like file sharing or voice over IP. The local area network private address is not going to help you because there's no easy way to get to it. So discovery is one of the first challenges. How do you discover the address you need to reach? And that would be the WAN address. And how do you go about accessing once you understand that? That's generally done with a registration process. So the nodes on such a network are generally registered by a server or super node. So there's an application program that runs on your host machine and registers with that site. That site has a domain name, which can be discovered in the domain name system. And so you're able to contact that server, and then all the other nodes are registered there, and that's the method whereby you can discover the other nodes. NAT traversal is again an issue, and it's even more of an issue because there are two NATs that have to be traversed and two firewalls. Asymmetrical bandwidth is also more of an issue in this model. In the client-server model, the content was coming from the server to the host in most cases. Here, content is going to flow from the node across the internet, which means the upstream bandwidth of the node will be taxed. And as I said, in access networks like DSL and cable networks, the upstream bandwidth tends to be on the order of 1/10 of the downstream bandwidth. Security is another issue for peer-to-peer service. We need to traverse the NAT and firewall, which means some sense we're going to poke holes in them and defeat some of the characteristics of those two devices. And in so doing, we have the potential to open up some security issues for our local area networks. And finally, optimization. Peer-to-peer networks can be either structured or unstructured. Many of them are unstructured, which means they are ad hoc. That is, the network is not planned or designed or hierarchical. It simply evolves as a function of who registers and where, and the server, the registrar, may not understand where those hosts are. So when we go about trying to do file transfers, for example, it may not be obvious which are the logical nodes to act as the sources for the files we're trying to transfer. This is a partial list of services that are peer-to-peer based. Skype, of course, is the application that was purchased by Microsoft and has tens of millions of users around the world. It's a voice over IP peer network. BitTorrent is a file sharing network, as is Netella. Almost all VoIP networks are peer-to-peer. Skype doesn't happen to use the session initiation protocol, SIP, which is the most popular IETF-based protocol for VoIP, but companies like Vonage and the telephone companies themselves have VoIP services use SIP, and that is a peer-to-peer protocol. Spotify is a music streaming service, and that is also peer-to-peer. And finally, Smtp, the mail transfer protocol, while it is a client-server protocol from the client or host machine up into the mail server, between mail servers, it acts as a peer-to-peer. It is in a public network, not a private network, so it does not have the same NAT and firewall issues that I've mentioned earlier.